Hey guys, welcome back to Razorback Reels. Today we're doing something a little different. We have an all-girls panel. I'm your host, Clarissa Bustamante.
Eliza Roederer.
Chandler Rack.
And Kristen Balls.
Today we're going to be talking about the top five box office hits. Number one is 50 Shades of Grey.
Of course. I think maybe because of the whole Valentine's Day weekend this kind of happened, but I don't know. It's been a really popular book. Definitely. A lot of my friends definitely went and saw it.
Definitely.
We all went and saw it together.
You know, it just amazes me that it hit number one on the top five list. I mean, I saw it last weekend. Personally, did not think that the acting was good at all. I mean, it was very cliche, It surprises me that this actually hit the top number one hit.
Absolutely. We'll get into more detail about that a little bit later. Number two, we have The Kingsman, The Secret Service. Any feelings about that?
Good, I feel like this is like the perfect date movie because it has enough action for the guys, but then, you know, the girls would still enjoy it too.
Right, exactly.
Definitely an attractive cast.
Yes. And number three, we have the SpongeBob movie, Sponge Out of Water. Yes, no.
I love SpongeBob and I've always watched the show, so I loved it, but I mean, I feel like it kind of depends if you watched it as a kid, if you're going to get into it or not.
Absolutely. Right?
It definitely has a big fan base, so I see it. I can definitely see it being on the top five.
And
the
parents, so excited to see it.
And the parents laugh just as much as the kids, like in the theater. So I think it's perfect for all ages.
It's a good, yeah. It's a perfect family movie. Something you can take the entire family to. Great. And number four, we have American Sniper, still in the top five. What do you guys think about that?
This is about like the fifth week in a row or fourth week in a row. Now it's been on the top five. I mean, it's amazing how awesome this movie has been doing. I mean, definitely a bunch of gross money coming in and everything like that. So great job, guys.
Yeah, it's definitely not surprising that it's still in the top five. And I mean, I loved it. It's one of my favorite movies for sure.
Awesome. Why is it your favorite movie?
It's kind of nice for us to like relate to what people are going through over there because it's like real stuff, you know, it's not just
a way for us to get to see what's going on on the other side.
It was definitely a great placement in time as well, going on with everything that's ISIS and everything that's war-related over in Iraq. It was a great time for this movie to come out.
Right. Absolutely. And at number five, we have Jupiter Ascending. Did you guys go see that yet?
You know, I will never be a huge science fiction person, but the fact that Channing Tatum is in this, I mean, I say this every time, he is a huge draw and a huge fan base and everything like that. And Mila Kunis as well for the guys has a great fan base as well. But again, I can't conform to the science fiction type of movies.
But like you said, I feel like that really helps having two actors that are like normally not in those kind of movies to bring in bring those two fan bases together.
We have like the sci-fi, everyone who loves all that. All those graphics and lots of action going on, and then we have the people who simply love attractive people like Kenneth and Channing Tatum.
But Channing Tatum's beard thing that kills me.
Oh, you wore a little bit of eyeliner too.
Yeah, that's
if
too
anybody
funny.
Noticed that.
Not him, but
I mean, yeah. What does he do?
Works for him.
Yeah, I think it was a great movie, and I think it's something, like, I took my dad to go see it when he came to visit me, and he loved it.
Yeah, so something too different. You know, groups, they're like two different kinds of movies can kind of relate to together.
Absolutely. Okay, we'll continue the show after these commercial messages. Stay tuned.
Hold your breath. Make a wish. Count to three.
Come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look and you'll see into your imagination.
Welcome back, guys. We're going to continue the show by continuing talking about 50 Shades of Grey. I know you guys probably have really strong opinions about it. What do you think?
I don't know. I feel like it's one of those things that was better as a book, maybe.
Okay. Did you read all the books?
Yeah, but I don't know. It's just so different. It's hard to come from a book because you compare it so much. Mm-hmm. Although it's also one of those things where, like, people that went and saw the movie, you kind of need to read the books, too.
You know, I completely agree 100%. The book wasn't even that awesome of a book. It was just so risque that it had such a great fan base. But the fact that they made this then into a movie with already not being the best writing, like, style of a book and then going into acting, I just didn't feel like it was very, I don't know. The acting was just really, it was bad, bad acting. It was really cheesy, corny. I mean, the only thing that I really liked, the good takeaway, was the soundtrack.
What do y'all think the target audience for this movie was? Because, I mean, there's a lot of adult themes in it, but at the same time, it's, you know, a series of book just like Twilight. So, I mean, what kind of age range?
I feel like it's women from, like, I mean, like, college aged and up. I mean, my mom and all her friends read the books. Like, we all went to Mexico for a trip, and they were all sitting there on the beach reading the books together. It was kind of funny. But
yeah, it's just like Twilight fan fiction. It's like, it's based on the same thing.
Right.
Yeah. No, I definitely agree. I mean, my mom was the one that introduced me and said, okay, I know this is going to be kind of weird, but this book is so strange that you just have to read it. So
it's so strange that your mom is the one who recommended it to you.
Mom, and then my sister, and then it went to me, and it
like
just kind of,
I
don't really like to think about it as a family book. Definitely not something to like give as a lullaby or anything like that to a child.
And because it was a target audience of women, I think it was really smart on their part to have it on Valentine's Day.
Definitely.
I think that just made the movie.
That's the reason it got so successful, was the fact that it was released this Valentine's Day weekend. People, either the single girls went and brought a bunch of chocolates and everything like that and went to do that. I know, that was me. But then all the girls with the boyfriends went and brought their boyfriends there, and then, I don't know, I would never personally want to bring my boyfriend to watch that movie.
So you think if it wasn't Valentine's Day, it wouldn't be number one?
Definitely not.
No.
Yeah, I think that really helped for sure.
Well, good timing on their part. But yeah, no, this movie, I saw it, and I feel like it was built up a lot, and
definitely a lot
of hype. It sounds like a romance book, like something, you know, like sexy and fun, but when I was watching it was really disturbing, you know, like some of the themes in there, like some of the way, like, things are handled, and the fact that there's, like, a contract between the two people rather than just, like, a regular relationship, I think that was, like, very hard. It was hard for me to watch, and I don't know if, like, anybody else felt that way, or...
Yeah, it definitely objectified women in some way. It made me feel almost like he felt he could own her, and she had to sign off her body and be only his, and when she was leaving to go to Georgia to visit her mom, he was upset and saying, "You are mine, like, only mine," and... No one should ever have that kind of control. It's almost what's wrong with our generation of
Yeah, I was kind of emphasizing some issues that are like, you know, are really out there. And I don't know that that was the right way to go about the movie.
Absolutely. Do you think this has anything to do with like Twilight and like that relationship? The character of Edward was very,
very
overpowering, and he was very
controlling
all over her.
Yeah, they are kind of similar in that way. And I think they, even though they're so different as far as having different... I don't know what you want to say, like because the storyline is more the same, like the same idea kind of underneath there, if you really think about
kind of
it.
Different themes.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Definitely.
There's a lot of things that they have similar and a lot of things they have different.
Right.
But another show that's been trending is Eye Candy with Victoria Justice, and you guys might know her from Zoey 101. What do you guys think about her new show?
Weird role for someone that used to be a former Zoey 101 star to be playing in a murder mystery kind of, you know, thriller of a show. It just, I don't know, it doesn't seem to match up very well with
it. It is kind of strange when you look at it that way, but I feel like she's doing a really good job with it, even though you wouldn't really think of her as having that role.
Absolutely. I think she's like a great actress, and I think she's doing really well with this role, but I think that we just know her so well from her past work that it's really hard for us to adjust to this, you know, very independent, crazy, like, woman that she's playing here.
Right, which I guess could be a problem with Disney stars and, you know, former Nickelodeon stars in the past, is that kids see them, you know, like Miley Cyrus, Hannah Montana, being this good girl from this, you know, South, raised by her dad, all that stuff. And then, of course, when she starts becoming the real her, chopping her hair off and being blonde and swinging from wrecking balls, you know, that's how she is. She's older than, you know, she's 20-something years old, 22, 23 right now. And
she's 21.
Oh, 21.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, and we still see her, though, as this 12-year-old girl, which is hard for these kind of stars. Definitely is.
But I first watched a show, and I was hooked. It is chilling, it has action, it has mystery, and even though I wasn't expecting Victoria Justice to do a good job, I was pleasantly surprised. I think she's really doing well with this role.
Yeah, good for her.
Absolutely. Speaking of people in strange roles, Ryan Gosling is casted to play a part in the musical Beauty and the Beast. What do you guys think about that?
I think that he could definitely pull that off as far as the romance thing, being from The Notebook, of course.
Of course.
Right.
But I think he's kind of proved that he knows how to work that role for sure.
Mm-hmm. I mean, he has been in previous roles as being the romancer and everything like that. So, I mean, Lars and Real Girl, Blue Valentine, Crazy Stupid Love, all great examples of him being this character. But a beast for Ryan Gosling, I don't know how much those two correlate as
well, do you think,
the romance.
Do you think him and Emma Watson correlate at all?
No, I just can't see that. I think that she is just so intense and she's going to do a really good job in this. I think he may can match her, but I feel like, I don't know, it could go either way.
It does seem kind of random, I feel like.
Well, and it's a musical, and I'm not sure. I think Emma Watson might have done a musical before, but I don't think we've ever seen Ryan Gosling in that type of environment.
I mean, it definitely will be interesting to see him out of his element and to moving forward to different kinds of acting, because, I mean, we've noticed it with other actresses and actors, like Reese Witherspoon playing more serious roles or something like that. So it should, I mean, it's definitely going to be a good eye looker.
He actually tried to make a musical with his friend in 2007. They wanted to make a monster-themed musical, but it didn't work out, so they ended up making an indie rock band called Dead Man's Bones.
Oh.
And I actually looked it up on YouTube, and it's not bad.
Really?
But it's something you wouldn't it's something you wouldn't
expect.
But
so maybe he can't do it. I don't know.
So do you think it'll be a success or a flop or?
Well, I've yet to see a solid trailer for it, so that kind of is making me a little nervous that they haven't yet come out with a trailer. So stay tuned for that.
Speaking of musicals, Pitch Perfect 2 is coming out. Who's excited about that?
So excited. That movie was so funny when it first came out. I mean, I had myself laughing out loud, and that usually doesn't happen when I'm by myself watching a movie. So it was.
Did you guys like the first one?
I'm not a huge musical person, but it is pretty funny because it still has the comedy with it too. It's not just all like musical.
And they keep the same cast as well, which is really strong for sequels to do.
Yes, well, do you think some people might say that Anna Kendrick is doing way too many musicals? Are you guys getting tired of seeing Anna Kendrick? Or
I feel like if I could sing as well as Anna Kendrick, I would definitely do as many musicals as she did. She did an amazing job in Into the Woods in the last 5 years, and I just really think that with her voice, why not?
Plus, her comedy comes in as a good compatible, you know, companion, I guess, because there are so many instances where she says jokes and references to things that we talk about now, and uses that as, you know, her charisma, and it's very funny. It's very, very good.
So, do y'all think that the second one was a good idea, or is it one of those things where it would have been fine with just the first one, just one Pitch Perfect?
I think that the way they left the first one, it kind of needed to have a second one.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, I'm really excited. I think it's going to be just as good as the first based on the trailer.
The character, Rebel Wilson, who plays Fat Amy, looks hilarious, even more hilarious in this movie than the last one.
Yeah, she really added to the first one, making it so funny. So and I'm glad they kept her in it.
Exactly. Yeah. And Elizabeth Banks is also a big part of Pitch Perfect 2. She not only was one of the announcers, which are hilarious, but she also directed it. Or she helped direct it. And she's also going to appear in Magic Mike XXL. Which is strange.
Everyone's excited about that.
Yes. So glad to be having those men back in my life.
Well, some of the men that won't be coming back in your life is Alex Pettifer and Matthew McConaughey. What do you think about
so
that?
I'm so sad about Matthew McConaughey. I'm obsessed
with him. I mean, come on. He's getting old, don't you think?
That's
no,
true.
No, he still has got it going on, though. I mean, he is equivalent to probably Jennifer Aniston for boys. You know, he's in his 40s, still looking great. I think I'm going to miss him.
Yeah.
Definitely.
That is sad.
What about Alex Pettifer? Are you guys going to miss him? He was the blonde one, the one that played Channing Tatum's friend that he met on the construction site, and then he came in later.
Mm-hmm.
See, I don't know. He didn't seem to be much of a character that stood out to me, so I won't.
Yeah, he didn't stand out as much to me either.
He was in Beastly, and he was in another movie, but he's honestly one of my favorites. He's like one of my crushes. He was in I Am Number 4. Also, if you guys have seen that, but he was like discovered, I think it was like he was 4 years old. He was like discovered in a toy store to be like a Burberry model. And
oh,
so like, he's just gorgeous.
Are so you're definitely gonna be missing him?
Do you guys, have y'all seen the trailer? Is it?
Yeah.
Yes. Definitely a lot of great dancing by Channing Tatum. Mm-hmm. Big surprise, though. I mean, he moves so fluidly, and I mean, it's definitely going to be a chick flick, guaranteed. Yeah. It's Magic Mike, it's male strippers, but, you know, I think that this will probably be a good high-selling film.
All right, and now we'll show you, the audience, the trailer. If you guys want to get a peek of what we're looking at or what we're talking about.
Magic.
Magic Mike.
I love how the trailer ended with, "You're welcome." Like, they did us just like a huge favor.
We're bringing it back. You're welcome. There you go.
So what do you guys think about it? Are you excited or?
I'm so excited. I think it's going to be really good. I think that's a movie that you can definitely do a sequel to without it, you know, kind of ruining the whole first one.
And Channing Tatum is actually helping to write this one, which is kind of strange because I don't know if he has ever helped write any of his movies before.
Well, this will definitely be interesting. I mean, I'm almost kind of seeing it being the, like a 50 Shades of Grey almost, where it's enticing to watch because of, you know, male strippers. It's kind of a different kind of theme of a movie, but not much of a plot type story.
I know the first one had no plot, and definitely all the supporting actors that weren't strippers just were not exciting.
Right.
And I mean, I think this one, it kind of looks the same way. Like, honestly, it looks kind of trashy. Like, the way that it kind of looks like Spring Breakers also, when they kind of cut to like the beach. Or like 22 Jump Street, if you guys have seen that. Oh, they have that, like, you know, it's spring break, and so they're all at like Panama City or whatever.
Right.
And so I feel like it's kind of going towards that, where it's just trying to like settle, like, you know, like sexy spring break, alcohol, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like,
not much of a theme, more just about being a hype of a movie, being about, you know, sex, drugs, booze kind of thing.
Yeah. And I hope that they really keep like the dancing in this one, because Twitch, he got second place on season 4. I love him. I cannot wait to see him in this. And it's rumored that he and Channing are going to do like a little duo dance-off kind of thing.
That'll be perfect. I can't see Twitch as a stripper, though.
No.
That's
the yeah.
Channing is great. He started his career by being a male stripper. But, you know, Twitch started his career as a dancer, so I'm not sure how they're going to collaborate on that.
Right.
But do y'all think Amber Hood will be a good addition to the cast, or?
You know, I think so. It's always good to have new additions to cast and kind of see how the characters play out together and everything. So it should be definitely interesting and add more to the storyline and the plot.
And the last time we saw her was Stepfather, if you guys remember that movie. But I think Amber Heard will definitely be a good addition.
Yeah, it'll kind of change it up and not keep the, you don't want to bore everyone with the sequel. So I think that'll definitely help.
Absolutely. And with that, we'll be right back after these commercials.
What I said, 'cause two can keep a secret if one of them is dead.
Welcome back, guys. We're now going to talk about the movies that are coming soon, starting with the movie Big in Japan.
I'm not sure about this. This doesn't sure about that one. This doesn't really look like it has a solid storyline by
definitely
any means.
Not.
I mean, it looks like it has a storyline, but not a very interesting
one. Right. Like, I mean, it just seems so, like, cliche and it's been done.
Absolutely. Everyone's trying to make it into wherever, you know. Right. Now they're just happening to go to Japan, you know.
They go to Japan, it's going to fail. Then all of a sudden at the end, they're going to make all these friends and it's going to sell out and do this amazing thing. And they're in debt at first and they're probably going to be, you know, well off afterwards. It's very cut and dried. Didn't really like the trailer, just kind of predictable.
Right, so not something we're planning on seeing.
No. Definitely.
Another movie coming out is All the Wilderness. How do you guys feel about that one?
This one didn't seem too interesting to me. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe it'll turn out to be better than the trailer, but I don't know.
If the trailer doesn't bring you in, though, I mean, I've been feeling I was feeling the same way. The trailer did not draw me in. I mean, Danny DeVito's in it, great actor and everything, very well-respected, well-known and everything. But other than that, I mean, it's a dad, or it's a boy who's struggling. He's in his awkward teen phase, you know, getting in trouble.
I think it looks kind of meaningful, you know, in its own weird way. Like, I think there's, like, something more to it.
Yeah.
I mean, it'll have some cool elements. I mean, it keeps referring back to this wilderness and how his dad, who passed away, you know, keeps, you know, referencing back to it and mentioning it, so.
Definitely a coming-of-age movie, just like the movie Boyhood.
Right.
Next, we have Hot Tub Time Machine 2. John Cusack, Chevy Chase is in it, and I don't know if you guys know who that is, but he was a huge SNL legend. He was in it from the very beginning, and now he's in this, and that just makes me so happy. What do you guys think about it?
I'm actually excited about it. I think from the trailer, it looks better than the first one.
That's what I was thinking.
It looks a lot funnier. Yeah.
It's funny because in the last one, you know, they went to the past, and they became all the, you know, did the inventing and pretend to be all these famous people and everything like that. The sequel is awesome because it's bringing them to the future. So it's bringing it to two totally different sides. Adam Scott's in it, hilarious actor. I'm so glad that they're bringing him back after his Parks and Rec career.
Absolutely. And next we have McFarland USA. I know it got 6.8 out of 10 on IMDb, but that's all I know about it.
Kevin Costner, he is at it again. I mean, he just had Black and White, and now he's coming out with this. I think it's going to be really good.
Definitely about to say the same thing. I mean, it's one of those hype-up sports movies, almost like Miracle, but with track stars and with this team that, you know, is from dirt, from, like, you know, they came from nothing, and now they can kind of become something.
Yeah, I think it looks really good. Looks awesome. And lastly, we have The Duff. And, you know, Duff stands for a designated ugly fat friend, which is so terrible. But Mae Whitman from Perks of Being a Wallflower and Bella Thorne from Shake It Up is on it. So I think it might be okay.
I think it might be funny. I mean,
definitely a chick flick to see.
I'm definitely looking forward to taking all my friends and going to see this. I feel like it's one of those kind of movies.
Definitely.
Yeah.
All right, well, we're going to leave you the trailer. We're on every single Wednesday, and we'll see you then.
Ooh, showtime.
For generations, you could only be a jock, a geek, a princess, or a basket case.
I'm my own best friend.
But what I didn't know was I had a brand new label.
There's my favorite Duff.
Sorry, what?
Duff, D-U-F-F, designated ugly fat friend.
What did you just say to me?
Look, I didn't mean it like that. Every group of friends has one. You're the one who's approachable. You friended up. Good for you.
You can't take it literally. You know, hot older women are cougars, but they can be full human.
I have no idea what the hell you're talking about. It was becoming harder and harder to deny the truth. Why was I Bosley? There were three angels. Everything and everyone can suck it.
Whoa, someone's in a mood. Lighten up.
Lighten up because I'm so heavy.
Oh, no, you didn't. I didn't say that. Yes, you did. You won't
return. I don't want to be anybody's Duff anymore.
Don't you hate me?
Yes, I do. But you're the only one in this whole school who told me what was actually going on. I will make sure you pass science if you help me with this.
You got the easy part. I have to reverse Duff you.
So you'll do it?
On one condition. You got to ask me in your monster voice.
From when we were little?
Mm-hmm.
No. I don't remember it.
You sure?
Yes, I don't. I couldn't even.
Whoa, 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 whoa!
Well, where do we start with me?
You got a uniboob, your posture sucks, and your clothes fit weird because you wear the wrong size bra. Boom. I watch a lot of Project Runway. What's up?
You need to talk to 15 guys without completely falling apart.
No.
Be totally gangster about it.
Excuse me. I can't do this.
People like you will never matter, so stop messing it up for those of us who do.
For forget her. Prove her wrong.
I'm gonna be a dateless weirdo for the rest of my life and end up like my mom.
You need to realize you're only as awesome as you think you are.
You look crazy.
Crazy amazing. Let's do this. Yeah, I'm somebody's duff. So are you. So is everybody. But it shouldn't affect how you see yourself. I need to talk to you.
Question?
Stop. I have a date. Not bad for a duff, am I right?
She's pulling it off.
Dude, she's 17 years old, man.
She's a 10. I don't care about 17. She's a 10.
Believe it or not, I was a duff.
What?
There was no cool name. It was like douchebag. A. Urkel. Asian Urkel.
Nerdass.
Didn't need the help.